Hi, welcome to Guideline Updates with Bed Study. I'm Dr. Kashif Piracha, and below this video is a link to the KDIGO 2021 Clinical Practice Guideline for the Management of Blood Pressure in Chronic Kidney Disease. This guideline updates the previous KDIGO guideline on this topic released in 2012. Strict BP control is important for all patients. However, it is even more vital for patients with hypertensive complications like chronic kidney disease. This guideline makes a notable change to proper BP measurement procedures and target BP goals. Consistent with the approach taken by KDIGO 2012 guideline, the recommendations of the current guideline also exclude patients on dialysis. Moreover, separate recommendations are made for specific populations, including children and transplant recipients. The guideline is inspired in large part by the SPRINT trial. In this trial, patients with hypertension and increased cardiovascular risk, but without diabetes, were assigned to two BP-lowering arms. The target systolic blood pressure was 120 millimeters of mercury in the intensive arm, and it was 140 millimeters of mercury in the standard arm. One of the key features of the SPRINT trial was how BP was measured in the trial population. These were standardized measurements, not routine office measurements. This is exactly the reason the current guideline introduces a new chapter dedicated to proper BP measurement techniques. The need for this arose because BP values are highly variable in the routine office setting, and all the large randomized trials consistently use standardized, not routine BP measurements. Some of the salient features of reporting a standardized BP measurement include: number one, patient should be sitting in a chair, relaxed, with an empty bladder and must not have consumed any stimulants in the last half hour. Number two, a proper BP cuff size, which encircles 80% of the arm, should be used. Number three, at first visit, BP should be recorded in both arms. The arm with the higher reading should be used for subsequent measurements. And last, and number four, an average of two or more readings on two different occasions should be used to estimate the individual's level of BP. Strictly adhering to these steps will ensure that trial data and outcomes can be successfully reproduced in the clinical setting. All healthcare personnel, including myself, now have validation to implement these steps in our clinical practices. All patients with CKD, except children and transplant recipients, should now be treated to a target systolic BP of less than 120 millimeters of mercury. This is a notable change because in the 2012 guideline, it was recommended to decrease BP to only less than 140 over 90 millimeters of mercury in CKD patients without albuminuria and less than 130 over 80 millimeters of mercury in those with albuminuria. This intensive BP lowering is associated with reduced rates of fatal and non-fatal major cardiovascular events and death from any cause. It is important to bear in mind that there are no renoprotective benefits of this intensive BP reduction. In fact, GFR decline was more pronounced in the intensive BP arm as compared to the standard arm, even though albuminuria reduction was more in the former versus the latter. Therefore, it appears that the beneficial effects were mostly due to improved cardiovascular outcomes. From a renal perspective, whether reduction of albuminuria is a better endpoint than GFR decline needs to be further studied. One significant aspect of strict BP control is individualization of therapy for each patient. Patients with CKD are frail and are prone to adverse effects like postural hypotension, which can increase the risk of falls. If a patient cannot tolerate a systolic BP of less than 120 millimeters of mercury, despite a slow gradual reduction, the goal should be adjusted. This approach is essential as healthcare targets in the future will be more focused and tailored to individual needs. I, along with other healthcare providers, am now looking forward to this intensive lowering of BP in our patients while making sure the side effects are minimized and the benefits outweigh the risks. all hypertensive patients with CKD should aim for dietary sodium reduction to less than 2 grams per day. Caution, however, is advised in the use of potassium-containing salt substitutes to achieve this goal, which can lead to hyperkalemia. Close monitoring of serum potassium levels should therefore be helpful. Patients should strive to achieve moderate intensity physical activity, which is up to 150 minutes per week. This goal should also be tailored to the patient's cardiovascular and physical tolerance. The choice of antihypertensive therapy has stayed the same as in the 2012 guideline. Patients should be treated with renin-angiotensin system inhibitors. Diuretics can be used for volume management. For transplant recipients, the target BP continues to be less than 130 over 80 millimeters of mercury, which is the same as in the 2012 guideline. Major reasons for this are the exclusion of transplant patients from the SPRINT trial and the fact that kidney allograft survival is the most dominant concern in this population. With a greater reduction in GFR in the intensive arm, as stated previously, keeping BP a little higher was considered a wiser approach for these patients. These patients should preferably be treated with a dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker and an angiotensin receptor blocker, but not an ACE inhibitor. Trials have shown that these drugs reduce graft loss even though there are no cardiovascular or survival benefits. The advantages of ACE inhibitor therapy in these patients are less convincing. Finally, let us take a moment to discuss BP control strategies in children with CKD. Based on ESCAPE trial findings, using ambulatory BP monitoring, all children with 24-hour mean arterial pressure consistently above the 50th percentile of normal children with corresponding age, sex, and height should be treated with an ACE inhibitor or angiotensin receptor blocker. Previous guidelines only recommended initiation of antihypertensive therapy when children were greater than 90th percentile. This change will allow us to treat a larger number of children, which will prevent hypertensive complications down the road. In summary, only standardized BP measurements should always be recorded. Furthermore, all hypertensive patients with CKD, except children and transplant recipients, should be treated to a target systolic BP of 120 millimeters of mercury or lower. I hope this guideline update has been helpful to you, and thanks for joining us.